Hello guys, and welcome to a new war game video today by me, Vulcan. Today I have for you the second round of the 7th BTR Flash tournament, which is the 2v2 tournament which I covered in the last war game video. Now this game is B5P, who obviously won the first round, and they're moving on into the second round where they're facing Vikings. Now Vikings has a Firestarter on their team, and Firestarter is an incredibly good player. He has played all the way back since European Escalation. I'm sure many of the people who play in these tournaments have done the same. But Firestarter is particularly somebody I remember who was very good throughout all the games so far. So that'll be interesting to see how he affects this game. Now, I'm not going to attempt to pronounce his teammate's name. So we'll just refer to them from now on as the blue team. I'm going to go over and have a look at what they're doing on the red side. I'm not sure how the strategies are going to change. I wouldn't be surprised to see if the red team use very similar decks to what they used in the last episode, because they did like come out on top in that game. So I wouldn't be surprised to see them keep their strategy the same. So it would likely be the heavy amount of APCs with the sort of medium tank support in the form of MBT-70s. Now this is a much larger map. This is paddy fields, and therefore we have a lot of open space in the middle here that is going to be host to a lot of HGMs, I would assume. And over on the left, they're proving me right, the PBBs 302As with the PVGRP HGMs in them. I think that's right. They are the very heavy HGMs from the Swedish side. So it looks like we're bringing in a Swedish deck here with Firestarter. Actually, both players are using Swedish units, but Firestarter in particular, I think, is using an entirely Swedish deck, unless they both are. Let's have a look at the units on this side. Yeah, looks like they both are. That's really interesting. I did not expect to see that. It might be Scandinavian decks, so that they get all of the units from the Scandinavian nations. That's probably more the case. If they were specifically Swedish, that would limit their possibilities quite a lot, I think. But anyway, they're going with TGB-13s with the Command Infantry to start off by capturing Oscar and Kilo at the start of the game. On the other side, we see Iltis Kados being used to capture Alpha, and we've got a UH-60A Blackhawk here with Command Infantry capturing Foxtrot. Now, what's interesting is that it looks like Blue Team are going with 4 Command Vehicles at the start, and the Red Team are going for 5. Because we've got 3 here, 3 Iltis Kados, and then we've got the 2 UH-60A Blackhawks with Command Infantry. So that will give a lot more points to the red team at the beginning of the game, which, if the game extends, will give them a huge advantage. Now, it is good to point out that this game is going to be roughly 44 minutes, so you're going to be with me for a while as this game goes on. I have not watched this replay before. I have not planned any of my commentary. I never do. I do this completely live, and it'll be extremely exciting to see what goes on here. Now, I'm interested about this unit composition. We've got these TRSP-CH-53Gs. Now, these generally, if you bring them in, they carry the Fallschirmjägers, I think. The Fallschirmjäger 90s. They're basically just really powerful infantry, but the helicopters cost so much to bring in, so that's a lot of points invested there into helicopters that pretty much become useless once you've dropped off the troops. Down here we've got, if we just pause it, we can have a quick look at the unit compositions. 4 M113A1Gs with Jaegers. We've got Marder 183, probably Panzergrenadiers. We've got SP-11 2 Kurs, a Flak Panzer Gepard A1, and another 4 M113s with Jaegers. We've got 2 AOH-58CSs here, anti-helicopter infrared. Then we've got the 6 TRSPs with the Fallschirmjägers. We've got 4V150s. These will probably have seals, I would assume. Then we've got two M2A1 Bradley IFVs. They've got their riflemen in them if they're the same as the last time. Then we've got an M1 IP Abrams and two M1A1 HC Abrams. So that's an interesting start from the red side. I think they're investing into a lot of these helicopters mainly to get the jump on the enemy at the start of the game in order to be able to capture any buildings that they need without being pushed back so quickly. So the Phantom 2 coming in here, basically napalm this road to make it harder for this push to get to this town, which is going to allow the red team to push up their Fallschirmjägers and land them in this town, which will prevent the capture of India. So that's a really interesting move there. Again, bringing in the napalm, it's very nice to see napalm used in war game effectively like this, because that has completely blocked this ramp. And if Firestarter is going to drive straight through that, then that is going to cause some problems for his troops, and it will do a lot of damage to these APCs, as you can see it starting to do if you look at the bottom of the screen. So they've already lost like 3 health on each of those, and they're getting stunned in the second lot of. Oh wow, they're getting stunned in this napalm. That's doing a ton of damage to these APCs, and it's also panicking them off the bat. And if the red team can get back these CH-53Gs at the start, the blue team won't know that there's Fallschirmjägers in this town. This is going to be horrendous for the blue team if they get their APCs sniped right off the bat. Okay, so they already lost a unit of Panzerskeisen there because they didn't manage to drop out the PVBs in time. F-15D Eagle comes in, dropping 4 1,000-kilogram bombs onto that push. Only destroys one unit of Panzerskeisen and the APC that was with it, but there is also this push here that's coming up behind it. So we got two STRV-103Cs. These are providing fire support behind the PVBs. We've also got an engagement on this side. Sorry, this is why I paused the game here, so that we could see the advance of these M113s with the Jaegers onto this compound here. Now, this fast advancement up the map on the right side has basically forced Firestarter to drop his troops into this compound to prevent this push. Now, the red team are losing a lot of their Jaeger squads here by not dropping them out of these APCs, and that is going to greatly affect them during this game. We do see a SK-60B come in here. That makes use of high power anti-ground missiles, so that was probably used to attack the Fallschirmjägers. But the Fallschirmjägers occupying this town is going to make it very hard for the blue team to control India from now on. But the huge push from the Jaeger squads in this compound has forced back the units that were defending there. It was only Panzerskeisen and the PBGRP HGMs, so it's no real surprise, but it's just incredible how the red team has made so much ground that early in the game. We see the Phantom 2 coming in again. It's going to drop his napalm right on top of these two PVGRP squads. They have the RBS-56, which is the Sacklos missile I was talking about, the shorter range but high AP power HGM. The Fallschirmjäger is still going to work on the APCs as they get close. Sorry about the camera jolting there, but it seemed to be a little bit of a bug in the special viewer that forces you to zoom in onto the aircraft. I guess it's not too bad. It makes it quite interesting. But now we can see that red team moving across a couple of V-105s, and they're trying to spot any advancement into this forest, and you can see that they spotted that and therefore told the UH-60A Black Hawk to attack this TGB M42. Now the TGB M42 will take a lot of damage from the twin miniguns of the Black Hawk, so I wouldn't be surprised to see the Black Hawk win that engagement. Over on the left, it's cool to see the use of these heavy tanks in order to secure hotel for now. But with this SK-60B coming in, the red team's going to have to be careful that they have enough AA in order to support this kind of push. So the F-15D Eagle coming in, trying to make a difference in the center. Two Veeks trying to stun it as it drops its bombs, but it gets away just fine. and does manage to land a nice few bombs onto these two STRV-103Cs, which are the Swedish tanks. So it looks like the blue team's going for a push now onto this town, and with enough fire support in tow, it looks like they may be able to force out any Fallschirmjägers on the edge of the town. But there is still a Panzergrenadier squad and two Fallschirmjägers left. So if these PVBs get too close without dropping out their troops, they are going to get blown up. And there we go, another Panzerskeisse squad lost. Now I'm surprised that the red team let them get that close on the right side. Obviously, this is a big map, so we've got to consider that they are looking all over the place. And it's sometimes pretty hard to keep track of all your unit movements, especially if you're micromanaging units in the back line. But I would have liked to have seen the Fallschirmjägers move forwards sooner, so they could have taken advantage of any APCs that got too close early on. But SK-60B here was ordered to evacuate before it could use its missiles, because that was flying directly towards two flak panzer Gepard A1s and an FRP Roland 3. The SK-60B coming in did manage to kill off a M36, but not really what you're looking for as a kill target. Now these M36s are sluggers, not wolverines, like I said in the last video, so I apologize about that. But they are interesting support units. They do have a front armor of 2, side armor of 2, a back armor of 1. They have zero top armor, so bombs can hurt them really badly. But they do have eight AP power and a decent accuracy for their price, which is why people make use of them, because they're decent for sniping the APCs of the enemy. So if Phantom 2 coming in here with another napalm strike is going to block this road from being used as an attack point, stop any fast move infantry pushes into this town. But I'm surprised to see that the blue team is confident enough to put a command vehicle into India, but they really do need to do that in order to level out the conquest score, because all the time that they didn't have a command vehicle in India, the red team was at an advantage by +2. So it was important that they made that difference there. The blue team are investing in a lot of CVs, bringing up another one now in order to capture Lima. The red team haven't done the same for Echo, so that will put the blue team at an advantage for a little while. It looks like an M1A1 Abrams was lost on this left side. With these large amounts of HGMs being used, the PV-RBV-551 and the PV-GRP-RBS-56, it is causing the red team to lose a lot of valuable units. So they already lost an M1A1 Abrams to one of these PV-GRP squads, and these M2A1 Bradleys aren't going to stand much of a chance either, especially considering these squads have 26 AP power. Oh, a huge mistake here. LAV-C2 drives straight into the enemy HGMs, and that will not be capturing Hotel anytime soon. The blue team investing a lot of points into getting India back, but as you can see, the red team does have a lot of units in the area. A lot of spread out infantry. I would have liked to have seen these Jaegers in two squads of twos, but the nice thing about this infantry sector in this town is that it is covered from all directions, so it won't be attacked by all of the extra fire support that is available. Just as I say that, the fire support moves left and these Jaegers will be targeted. So an engagement here between the Jaeger squads and the Panzerskeisse as they try and advance, but all this is doing, the Panzerskeisse are basically baiting the Jaegers to attack them, and then the long-range autocannons and main guns of the tanks are able to destroy the squads without the Panzerskeisse actually taking that much damage. Now Phantom 2 does come in, isn't quite shot down. Also an F-15 D Eagle is going to drop bombs directly on top of the napalm as well, just to get rid of all that Panzerskeisse with the PVV-302As. So with the majority of the APCs being destroyed, it's interesting to see these M113s being pushed forwards in order to suppress the infantry that's left over. So these M113s can use their MG3s in order to take out those squads pretty well. And it is going to waste the missiles of this SK-60B that's flying over the top. But that has just flown straight into an AA area, which is covered by three FRP Ronin 3s and two Black Panzer Gepard A1s. Now, I'm not sure on the Scandinavian deck whether they have any really effective seed, which is going to definitely hurt them if they allow these FRP Ronin 3s to remain alive. Also, they don't seem to have access to much AA either, which is really starting to harm their ability to shoot down the F-15D Eagle and the Phantom II. And that was a problem that I pointed out in the last video, was that the F-15D Eagles were literally running all over the enemy team, and it seems to be starting to happen again here. But the blue team is making ground as they slowly push forwards with the SCRV 103Cs and the PBV 302A support. The Phantom II comes in, does end up napalming their own squad, which is interesting, and absolutely misses the Panzer Skyte. So, an interesting move there. Possibly would have liked to have seen the Phantom come around the side of the map and then land a napalm strike across the town from this direction. And that would have been a lot more effective than just bringing in the strike from that direction. And I don't think it would have taken much damage from the Veeks because they would have been out of range anyway. Now we've got a Milan F2 squad here that is starting to harass the STR V103C here. So that is being forced to reverse. The STR V104. This is a much cheaper tank, I believe. Yes, only 45 points. But if he's not careful, yeah, the HGMs are still going to kill it. Same with these STRFs coming up the ramp. It's good to see them being stopped on the edge of that ramp because they, of course, will be targeted by the HGMs if they pushed up. So it's a good micro play from both sides so far. Maybe the red team have made a few more mistakes than they should have. The Eyehawk being destroyed there is probably another one. They already know that there's HGMs up here, and I'm not sure why they're revealing their units unnecessarily. That was a lucky miss there by this PVGRP squad, otherwise would have killed this M2A1 Bradley IFV. But that got a lucky shot onto the HGM unit of the blue team, so that is going to reduce one of their HGMs. Now, it's good to see the use of the STRFs in combination with the Panzer Skyte in order to take out the two Milan F2 squads that were sitting in this town, and that is going to give a lot more flexibility to the blue team's vehicles. The Phantom II now come in, but oh damn. The blue team has invested in two RBS 67 Hawks. This is what I was looking for. Some heavy AA from the Scandinavian side. It's going to be able to take down that Phantom II and will prevent the enemy from making use of the F-15D Eagle near this town anytime soon. Now, unfortunately, the Hawks aren't good enough in order to cover this line of attack from aircraft, so the second Phantom II that comes in does manage to land an napalm strike there. Now we've got the Panzer Grenadiers against the Home Guard of the Scandinavian side. We've got a Harrier come in, and that got shot down by the Hawks as well. This SK-60B with its very powerful missiles able to make a strike, and this F-15D Eagle so close, but luckily with its... I'm just stunned because I think they just took out two units of Panzer Grenadiers of their own. Anyway, The F-15D Eagle was lucky to get away there. I think it was really just its ECM that allowed it to remain alive. The Model 1A3 did manage to take out a unit here. Looks like it was just a PBV. Oh, but the Iltis Kado that was neutralizing India was spotted shortly. And that was being fired upon by the STR-V-103B. But that is probably going to end up getting out of there. And it looks like the AA that was supporting the Red Team's push is now being retreated. So they're going to have to get that out of there pretty soon. Otherwise, all of these advancing APCs will start doing a lot of damage. So the Panzer Grenadiers have managed to get back into this town. That's another two units that they've brought up, and they are a lot more effective than these Home Guard and Panzer Skyte. So I'm pretty sure that they would win the battle, but Blue Team did bring in a couple of SK-60Bs again, and they are going to use their missiles to turn the tide of that fight in their favour. The use of these Marder 1s and the Panzer Grenadiers are going to take out these Home Guard units in the middle of the field. We've got the PBV 302 attacking these two Marder 1s. They're supported by 8 M36 Sluggers. And a nice napalm strike again from that Phantom 2. It's going to start dealing a lot of damage to this infantry and dislodging them, allowing the Panzer Grenadiers and Marder 1s to take them out completely. Over on the left, the use of the F-15D Eagle is taking effect, actually managing to destroy one of these IKV-91s and a recon squad that was occupying that forest. But most of the fighting is going on this side, and I think what the Red Team is really trying to do is apply pressure on this side in order to neutralize India, because it's a +2 sector. It is going to make more of a difference than if they tried to contest Hotel instead. And Hotel is a lot harder to capture with a command vehicle. So although they managed to get this command vehicle in here earlier, this LAVC2, it looks like it was sniped earlier on, because it's a pretty obvious place to put it. The only way you're really going to capture that sector is by making sure that the enemy has nothing on the opposite side. And just by having this HGM unit sitting right here, it's going to stop any command vehicle from being placed in Hotel. So it's interesting that this AV-8A Harrier is just free to fly in this far and take out this unit that was sitting on the beach. That did get hit by the LVGRP squad, which has a SACLOS anti-air missile. But that will still get away on 2 health, so not much of an issue there. Now, with the Blue Team managing to take back India, it's nice to see that they're now pressing with all of these Home Guard towards Bravo. And the Harrier comes in, drops a couple of bombs onto these squads, but doesn't actually end up doing too much damage as these Home Guards slowly advance. Now, the trouble with using Home Guard is that they are incredibly slow. They move so slowly. If you look at them, they just almost run in slow motion. It's pretty ridiculous. Whereas the Panzer Grenadiers, they have a run speed of 25 kilometers per hour. Imagine if you could run that fast. Anyway, a nice Phantom 2 napalm strike is going to prevent this push for a little while. And it's interesting to see the use of this AH-64D longbow in order to suppress some of these Home Guard squads with its main gun, but it's also firing Hellfire missiles at these STR-V-103Cs at the same time, which it did spot with its exceptional recon. So that's a nice little prize there for that longbow, and it has almost paid itself off because of that. But now we've got the use of an EA-6B Prowler that's coming in with its two anti-radar missiles, and it is looking for the kills onto these two RBS-67 Hawks. But they're well aware that the aircraft is in the sky, and they do have their radar turned off. So as long as the radar's turned off, the Prowler's not going to be doing anything. So instead, the red team's relying on these mortars in order to get the kills instead. Oh, a nice direct hit there from that 120mm mortar is going to kill one of the RBS 67 Hawks, and now they're going to remain hidden in this forest. HGM Snipe from the PVGRP is going to take out Armada 1 and Panzer Grenadier squad on the end of this forest. But we also see this longbow managing to get cross shots with its Hellfire missiles onto this road, and it is going to stop Firestarter from pushing up this STRV 103C. So Harrier coming in here with two 500 kilogram bombs is going to go for a little bit of a guess onto where the enemy units are, and did get itself shot down trying. So a bit of a loss there. We got the point out of two Veeks from the red team have spotted those with the, obviously the Harrier, and now they're going to run in with these Navy SEALs. They do have those 40mm grenade launchers, but the Home Guard holding them in place is going to allow these Veeks to come in and use their autocannons to wipe out these squads pretty quickly. Those autocannons absolutely ripping to shreds the squads of the Navy SEALs. So it looks like a Huey there being shot down by the M48A3 Chaparral. Basically just the Swedish variant of the Huey. Over on the right we have an engagement between an HGM Milan F2 squad and an STRV-103C, but as the STRV-103C does manage to kill the Milan squad before the missile hits, the missile is going to go off track. Now it's also interesting to see that that was a fire position, because obviously the HGM team will go like invisible while it's reloading. If you fire position onto the point at where the HGM was coming from, then you will often just kill the squad anyway, and that's what Firestarter was making use of there. So a nice tip actually, to make sure that you kill those pesky HGM squads that keep going in and out of view once they're firing their HGMs. Oh, a nice snipe there onto an M2A1 Bradley IFV from this PVGRP squad that has taken up residence in this compound. We've got the red team being pushed out of Lima. But this Prowler's now coming round and did manage to get a shot onto a Veek 40, so a nice kill there. And now the blue team are pushing hard to make a dent into Echo. So another PVGRP squad here. These are being utilized so well, these squads. They're five-man HGM squads, and they're just so resilient most of the time, and therefore can be used across fields like this on their own. And hopefully that will kill one of these Marder 1s. Nope, it won't, because it looks like the mortar fire from these M113 Panzer mortars is going to kill off those squads with the help of the Marders. But as these Panzer Skytier advance, it is revealing the Panzer Grenadiers in this forest, which is allowing the fire support to fire into the forest. And now it's pretty much up to these mortars to prevent this push, but a K1 being used here on the side of the red team. Now a K1, 85 point tank, 60% accuracy with 15 AP power, so pretty effective against APCs. Not great against STRVs, but it is going to start putting a lot of pain onto these STRFs that only have 4 front armor. Now the STRFs are incredibly good APC because of their 40mm autocannon. But what looks like another Phantom 2 has been shot down with the use of this RBS 67 Hawk. So the RBS is still being made use of, even though they are turning on and off the radar as they're being moved forward. Over on this side, It's interesting to see how these home guard are baiting out the shots from these Abrams, and it is going to allow, oh, a nasty side shot there into this Abrams from the PBGRP. This one squad here must have got so many valuable kills, it's actually ridiculous. So an AV-88 Harrier is going to get hit by the RBS 67 Hawks on the left that have been brought in to support that. So another Harrier lost there on the red team. They seem to be slowly losing air support, which I think is going to hurt them quite a lot. Because the Scandinavian team, unless they sort of run out of momentum, is going to continue pushing with these home guard and cheap infantry, which is exposing the heavier infantry to fire support. And it's just meaning that the price paid is just not worth it for the red team. However, I do like the way in which the red team are keeping their losses low by using the 15-point Panzer Grenadier squads. They're being countered by the Panzer Skyte squads that only cost 15 points. But if you think about the Home Guard squads that are being used, they only cost like 10. So when a Home Guard squad gets a Panzer Grenadier squad killed, then that's a lot more effective. So you see, with these Panzer Grenadiers being pushed over the open, it is revealing the position of the enemy's tanks and APCs, and therefore the red team is using those mortars to take those out, or at least try and stun them while the Panzer Grenadiers move across the open. Over on the left though, the red team doesn't have very much at all. There's an M1A1 HA Abrams and an M2A1 Bradley with an empty Hempt and two rifleman squads. That's all that's defending this side. That's incredible how they're getting away with that. It would have been interesting to see, especially considering there was a infantry squad here for a long time, which has now been taken up by this M1A2 Abrams. It would have been interesting to see that recon squad spot that and then see the blue team focus their attempts instead onto Hotel. But the red team has been ahead for a while now due to the fact that they've kept the blue team out of Lima and have had their own success in Echo. Now this is another, I don't want to say that the red team keep winning because they're on unfair maps, but if you look at like Echo compared to Lima in this map, Lima doesn't have any buildings really to defend this sector other than these two here, whereas Echo has an entire town and a much larger forest, which makes it a lot easier for the red team to hide a CV in this sector. And that's why they're managing to keep theirs alive, whereas the blue team's finding it a lot hard to keep theirs alive. And that's unfortunate, because that has cost them a lot in this game. Now this is why the blue team's trying so hard to push into Bravo. They know that their only hope is to really neutralize Bravo and cause them to go into like at least a plus one lead for the rest of the game. Now of course the timer is coming down on this game, so they are very rushed in order to do this. But these three STRV-102s, which are 30-point tanks, are moving slowly into this forest, but they are going to get targeted by this F-15D Eagle with the four 1,000-kilogram bombs, and yeah, with the bombs landing behind, that is going to go straight through the back armor and blow the crap out of those tanks. So here we go, the blue team now pushing quite hard. They've got four PBGRP squads moving across the open field, and the idea of using these is that they're going to try and spot out these K1s and destroy them from range. But they've got to be careful, because the K1 does match their range at 2,275 meters. So they're not at a range advantage ever in that engagement, and you can see that that is affecting them quite a lot. as these PVGRP squads move across the open, get spotted, and then the K1s can just take them out with like one shot. It's pretty ridiculous. So anyway, over on this left side, it has finally been reinforced, and with the Avenger coming up, that has managed to shoot down, I think that was an SK-60B, yep. There's two Avengers on this left side now, and it looks like they're trying to... This SK-60B, oh, just failed to hit the Iltis Kado. I think they knew where that was as well. If we quickly jump to their point of view... Oh, no, maybe not. A little bit of a misguess, I guess. They thought they knew where it was, but they still can't see it from now on because there is no recon in order to spot that out. They tried to move up this HKP, which is a recon helicopter, over the water, but that is going to get spotted and shot down by an Avenger, so no more recon for them. But they have put an attack marker directly on the Iltis Kado now, so I wouldn't be surprised to see another attempt at taking that out, because that is now keeping the red team at a plus one advantage after the blue team have managed to neutralize by getting a command squad into Lima. So the blue team, I think, have done extremely well to push up this far. This AH-1S Cobra now being taken out by an LVGRP squad. But they've done incredibly well to push up this far after being so far back in India. But I think they've really sort of run out of steam. And almost it was easier to push across the open here because they were closer to their reinforcement point. They could get more units in quicker in order to keep the push and the momentum going. But now that the units are much further away from their reinforcement point, it's a lot harder to maintain that push, especially when your units are slowly being picked off by the defensive forces that are in these forests. So there we go, another unit shot down there. HKPs being taken down by the Black Panzer Gepard A1s and the FRP Roland 3s. These K1s have done so much work on the enemy. And this strip BV as well here, my lord, that's getting incredibly close to the enemy. Another four 1,000 kilogram bombs from an Eagle, dropping onto another push of STRV 102s. This CV bumping into a Marder 1 that is going to spot that, and all they're trying to do is get this into Bravo in order to neutralize it at least for a little bit, just so that they can stop the bleeding. But with the infantry of the blue team being destroyed in this forest area, these Panzer Grenadiers are still alive, are going to get a heat rocket straight into the front of that CV, and that's not going to last very long at all. Now, it's good that the blue team did manage to take out the CV finally in Hotel, so they are now even in terms of command points coming in, but they are still behind 386 points on the red team and 51 and only on the blue team. So it's a pretty dire situation, especially with the push running out of steam on this side. So they've got basically just tons of AA here now. There is literally no substance to this force. It may look like, oh look, there's five units, but these are all AA, and that's just not something you want to see. So they've completely run out of steam on this side. All of their APCs got destroyed by these K1s and the Panzer Grenadiers and the Marder 1s. And unfortunately, I think it's just a matter of the units outclassing the others. I think the Marder 1s almost are just as good as the STRFs. And I think that the K1s were just like the perfect situational tank in order to deal with the units. Now, it's unlucky there that the SK-60B did not destroy the Iltis Kado with one shot. It looks like the missile was slightly off, and therefore they didn't get away with killing that. Now the red team knows that they know that the Iltis Kaido is there, and they're just going to move it to a different position, and that's going to make it incredibly hard for the blue team to get a second chance of destroying that CV. What I would have liked to have seen, though, I think from the blue team, is they should have spotted that there was it was much weaker on this side earlier, and they would have been able to push straight through Hotel and basically straight into Gulf and straight into Foxtrot. If you look, there's nothing defending this. There was only two units in Hotel and everything else was completely clear. They could have just fast moved all the way down here. Yeah, okay, you might have seen the red team bring in some reactionary forces, but I'm pretty sure they would have been able to hold at Gulf if they managed to get that far. But now the red team noticed their weakness on the left, have reinforced that, and now it's just a matter of holding back the blue team until they win the game. Now, I don't think the blue team really has any reason to surrender just yet. Now, they do have 5 minutes left, and if something miraculous happens, like they manage to, I don't know, maybe kill a couple of K1s on this side with these HGM squads, for example, then they might, you know, be able to make something of it. But it's most likely that any attacks they try and make are going to end up inevitably failing. We got two STRV 103Bs are coming up straight into the line of two MBT 70s. The main guns at that close range are going to do quite a lot of damage, but the STRV does have a rate of fire advantage, so yeah, it's going to be able to win that fight. So I thought the MBTs might be able to use their autocannons at that range. I don't think they were quite in range, though, in order to penetrate the front armor with those autocannons. They did manage to catch out one that was at its side armor facing, I think. But the STRV, proving why people like to use it, does have a high rate of fire and therefore can win those tight skirmishes in trees. Now, the M2A1 Bradleys that were pushed up on this side did get taken out, along with the rifleman squads, by the looks of things. This PVGRP squad, I don't think we'll have much of a problem taking out these last couple of riflemen. But it was nice to see that bombing strike come in from the F-15 in order to destroy those units of Home Guard. So an STRV making a break for it. Unfortunately, it did come straight up into the line of sight of these two Panzer Grenadier squads, and therefore it's going to take that out. The AH-64D longbow also had a shot there. And, well, it looks like the blue team has kind of given up. They should probably be grouping up in India and then maybe make a last-ditch effort for Bravo from there. Because if we look, they've already brought in a couple of cluster bombers in order to take out quite a lot of units in this tree line here. It's a shame that we missed that one. But the SK-60B is coming in to attempt to kill the CV again, but obviously that's been moved, and unfortunately they're not going to get that snipe. And now, to add insult to injury, the red team has brought in a infantry command squad to sit in the back of Hotel and add that plus one killing blow to this game. Now, I think that not really much is going to happen from now on. So if we talk about what made this game work in the red team's favor, I think was definitely the use of that napalm and the Fallschirmjägers at the beginning of the game. Basically, the napalm came down here and it allowed the Fallschirmjägers to get an incredibly good presence in this town at the start, which completely prevented the capture of India while they were easily capturing Bravo. But then, you know, they managed to even things out. The blue team managed to get a CV into Mike, but the red team got a replying CV into India to contest, which gave them a small lead. Then they both managed to get CVs into Lima and Echo, and it basically remained even for quite a while. But I think what really changed it was just like the positioning from the enemy. The blue team had to put so many resources into this right side in order to push back the red team, and that hurt them a lot. Now Viggen being used with cluster bombs in order to take out that M1A1 Abrams. Nice kill there. They also managed to kill an Eagle with an anti-air airplane, but all these kills are really not going to do very much this late in the game. It would have been nice to have seen the F-15s taken out much sooner, and that way they would have been less effective throughout the game, like the Phantom 2s were. So, yeah. I don't know. The air support from the red team has just been on point throughout this tournament so far, and neither team we've seen face them has really done much about it. So there we go. That's game. You can see the points really represent how much effort the blue team had to put in order to kill the red team. So you can see the kills and losses there, the losses being a lot higher than the kills, even though they managed to push back the red team. And that's why they kind of lost, like they ran out of steam when they were pushing back onto them. It's just the positional play at the start of the game really set the tone, I think. And then after that, with the blue team putting so much effort into pushing back the red team, it allowed the red team to make plays elsewhere around the map and really prevent the enemy from keeping the game even. And then that slowly bled out the game and allowed the red team to get a total victory. So, a very long recording there. It was a 40-minute game. And, wow. Hopefully, you guys enjoyed it. It was the full 40 minutes. They never gave up, and I commend that. But I think there was a point, about 5 minutes towards the end of the game, where they could have said, hey, that's enough. You know, blue team really didn't have a chance to get back in the game. But hopefully you enjoyed that one. It was a lot more, I don't know, strategic, I think, than the first game, where it was more like I think the first game was more of a stomp than the second game. The second game, it was really nice to see one team come back at the other. But that's all I'm going to say for now. I'm going to give my voice a rest. So thanks for watching. Hope you enjoyed it. And I'll see you in the next video. Goodbye.